Exciting Florida conference. I think we've got a great day lined up. We're going to be talking about healthcare, the environment, some of the core issues of our day. And now we're going to have the panel on federalism and religious liberty. Can't help but point out that we have all of our panelists here today, one of the few panels that do, which demonstrates the power of prayer, not yet infringed by the government. Thank you for coming. My name is Nate Adams. I'm a partner with the law firm of Holland & Knight, and I had the privilege of putting this panel together today. My job is to introduce our moderator, who I'm privileged to count as a personal friend. I was thinking last night that, you know, you're getting older in the law when you recognize that some of the persons that you recruited are now you're introducing as serving on the bench. So Judge Timothy Osterhaus worked at the Department of Education in the General Counsel Office for a period of time. He came to us, we recruited him from Washington, which I'm sure he's happy about this week at least, where he served for Aaron Fox and Harry Simon as an associate. When he left the Department of Education, Attorney General Pam Bondi had the good sense to appoint him as Deputy Solicitor General for a period of time, and then also as Solicitor General, where among other things, he had the opportunity to be among the 25 other states who challenged the 2010 Federal Health Care Act. After he was Solicitor General for about a year, Governor Rick Scott appointed him to the First District Court of Appeal, with the assistance, I'm sure, of some of the good folks in this room who were helpful in making sure that we get some great judges on the bench. So without further ado, I would like to introduce to you Judge Timothy Osterhaus.
Thank you very much, Nate, and thanks to the Federal Society for inviting me to participate, to moderate today what I think will be a fabulous panel and a treat for all of us here to start our Saturday morning. Over the last few years, it's been hard to miss the vigorous legal battle going on at the intersection of people's rights to live out their religious convictions, and on the other hand, the government's authority to regulate the workplace and other places as it sees fit. We've become familiar with the stories of bakers, photographers, florists, Hobby Lobby, small colleges, county clerks, and even the Little Sisters of the Poor, who insist on legal protection under the First Amendment or under the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, and what they consider to be overbearing government. And we struggle for a clear, for a broadly palatable answer to some of these issues. Today, I think we're going to get some of those answers. I'm excited about that. We're privileged to have assembled a first-rate panel of legal scholars here today who thought long and deeply about a lot of these issues and challenges and clawed their way in from universities up north that are frozen, and so we appreciate that. We'll hear first from Professor Michael Moreland down at the end. He's the Marianne Remick Senior Visiting Fellow and concurrent Professor of Law at Notre Dame and Professor of Law at Villanova. He joined the faculty at Villanova in 2006, served as Vice Dean from 2012 to 2015. In 2010 and 11, he was a Visiting Fellow at Princeton's James Madison Program in American Ideals and Institutions. And he teaches and writes in the area of law and religion. Received his BA in philosophy from Notre Dame, his MA and PhD in theological ethics from Boston College, his JD from Michigan, and following law school, clerk for Paul Kelly on the 10th Circuit Federal Court of Appeals. He served as associate director for domestic policy at the White House under President George W. Bush. Welcome, Professor Moreland. Professor Carl Esbeck, sitting next to me, is the R.B. Price Professor of Law Emeritus at the University of Missouri. Graduated from Cornell School of Law, where he served on Law Review. He then clerked for a federal judge and was an equity partner at a law firm in Albuquerque before leaving for academia in 1981. He served a stint in the office of Deputy Attorney General for U.S. DOJ during the George W. Bush administration and has directed a public interest law firm focused on constitutional law. Professor Esbeck regularly teaches and writes in the area of church and state relations. Finally, we have Professor William Marshall, who's the Kenan Professor of Law at the University of North Carolina. He previously served as Deputy White House Counsel and Deputy Assistant President Clinton. And I particularly like that he was the Solicitor General of Ohio at one point. Maybe presidential material these days. Professor Marshall has published and taught extensively on freedom of speech and religion, presidential power, federalism, and judicial selection. He received his law degree from the University of Chicago, his undergrad degree from Penn. He's a native of Nashua, New Hampshire, and perhaps you can tell us how the primaries will shake out here in a few weeks. So it's a really fine panel. Welcome all of you. What we'll do here is we'll hear from each of them for maybe 12, 14 minutes, then give them a chance to respond to each other, clarify positions, maybe address the flashpoints that are raised with each of the presentations and anything else. And then we'll open it up to you. I'll ask you to be thinking about questions as each presenter presents that you might ask them. And we have the microphone up here, and towards the end, we'll just line up and fire questions at the panel as we have time. And that should make for a good session. So with that, Professor Moreland.
Thank you, Judge, and thank you to the Federal Society and to Nathan Abbott for the invitation to participate. It's nice to get out of South Bend in the winter and down here to sunny, not so sunny, but at least slightly warmer Florida. So I'm kind of the warm-up act here. I'm going to speak for a little bit about kind of the background to some of the current issues that are in the law and religion field, and it is an exciting time in law and religion. The Supreme Court this term is hearing two cases involving religion. One I'll spend a little bit of time talking about is the Little Sisters of the Poor case, the challenge to the contraceptive mandate of the Affordable Care Act, and the other, which I won't spend time on, but if people are interested in during question and answer, we can talk about, is an aid case involving the state of Missouri and Blaine Amendment prohibition on aid to religious schools that the Supreme Court took cert on just about 10 days ago, and will be heard also later this term. But our panel will primarily focus on the sort of free exercise part of the religion clauses, and to that I'll just say a little bit by way of background to some of the issues that are in the news and confronting the courts today. So if you go back to the go-go days of the Warren and Burger courts back in the 60s and 70s, there was a period in which there was a general kind of heightened scrutiny to all kinds of constitutional rights claims, including claims under the Free Exercise Clause. So from a period of 1963 in Sherbert versus Verner until 1990, in Employment Division versus Smith, at least formally, claims for religious free exercise, that is, where the claimant asserted that the government had imposed a substantial burden on his or her free exercise of religion and forced the government to satisfy the strict scrutiny test that you're all familiar with from law school, that the government had a compelling interest and that the means of achieving that interest were least restrictive of the claimant's free exercise. And interestingly, and I'll talk a little bit about this again at the end, critics of that approach tended to come actually from the right. It was generally conservatives who were more skeptical about that kind of heightened scrutiny approach to religious free exercise claims. Then Justice Rehnquist, in a series of cases, sounded these notes. Commentators such as Walter Burns, who passed away last year, a kind of noted political theorist and constitutional scholar, who thought that this kind of approach to constitutional rights more generally, but especially to free exercise rights, was somewhat problematic. And but the interesting thing is that other than with some unemployment insurance cases, including Sherbert itself, and Wisconsin versus Yoder, a case in the 1970s involving mandatory school attendance by Amish school children, the claimants in those cases almost always lost. And so this gave rise to the view that strict scrutiny in the free exercise context was strict in theory, but futile in fact, not fatal in fact, but futile. And so this was cleaned up, clarified, distorted, depending on your view, in 1990 in Employment Division versus Smith, when the court kind of brought an end to that period and said that as to neutral and generally applicable laws, there is no constitutional right of free exercise exemption. And so you could still have failures of neutrality, and the court heard a case a few years later in Church of the Lukumi Babu Lai from right here in Florida, down in Hialeah, where there was kind of a targeted ordinance at the practice of Santeria. and other cases in the lower courts where you have failures of neutrality. You can also have failures of general applicability if the exemptions to a requirement are kind of carved out in such a way that religious exemptions are given second-class status to other kinds of exemptions. And there are lots of those cases we can talk about more if people are interested. But for the most part, it kind of brought an end to any kind of constitutional scrutiny of these free exercise claims. In response to that, and this is where, of course, this kind of ushered in the era in which we're in today, in response to that, Congress and many state legislatures, including Florida in 1998, but Congress in 1993 enacted the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, which restored, or purported, in actually in the statutory text, to restore the strict scrutiny approach of Sherbert and some of the cases from the 60s and 70s, and as a matter of statute required that government restrictions on religious freedom that again poses substantial burden would be subject to strict scrutiny analysis. And so that was kind of, it was not really that controversial at the time. I mean, it was, as has been rehearsed many times now, it was passed without much opposition in Congress. It was signed by a Democratic president, Bill Clinton. And it was really something that was favored both by those on the political left, groups like the ACLU and others, and evangelicals and Catholics and others who were solicitors of religious freedom for their own institutions. And so things were kind of quiet in the 1990s on the RFRA front, except for the fact that the court did, in 1997, hold that RFRA was unconstitutional as applied to states and local governments in a case called Florida versus Flores, which exceeded Congress's Section 5 enforcement power under the 14th Amendment. But you didn't have a lot of cases, and I think part of that was because it, both the Sherbert regime to some extent, but then post-RFRA, I think state legislatures, local governments and such, were kind of incentivized as because of RFRA to grant exemptions because of fear of litigation and the like. And but yet it was really not, not a source of, I think, tremendous controversy. Well, that all came to something of an end, I would say, about 5 years ago, or even shorter than that, really, 2011, 2012, as a result of some litigation that I'll talk a little bit about now involving the Affordable Care Act. So the Affordable Care Act requires, as one of its statutory provisions, that covered health plans include cost-free coverage for preventive services. And that's really what the statutory text says as much about that. But it delegates to the Department of Health and Human Services determinations of what will constitute those preventive services that employer-provided plans must cover without any copay. And so the department delegated to the Institute of Medicine, which is an independent board of physicians and other healthcare professionals, to kind of figure out what this should cover. And the IOM came back and said it should cover all FDA-approved contraceptives and some IUDs and other devices to which some, not surprisingly, had sincerely held religious objections. And so that was what ushered in then the firestorm that erupted in late 2011, early 2012, involving the HHS mandate. Now, it's important to note that the when HHS made this requirement in the regulations, it did exempt some religious institutions. Again, perhaps for peripheral reasons or otherwise, it did exempt some religious institutions. Initially, it had a kind of somewhat complicated four-part definition, later amended that slightly to say that basically churches and their integrated auxiliaries, barring a provision from the Internal Revenue Code, would be exempt from this requirement. So, an actual church, right, or a diocese would be exempt from this requirement to cover these services in their health plans. But it left entirely non-exempt other forms of religious nonprofits. So, employers like mine, Villanova, Notre Dame, or Catholic social service agencies, or religiously affiliated healthcare systems. And of course, it also left completely without exemption for-profit businesses. So the first wave of challenges to this emerged by for-profit businesses, famously Hobby Lobby in Oklahoma, Conestoga Wood, a company back home where I'm from in Pennsylvania, that had objections to some, not all, interestingly, but some of the requirements that HHS had imposed. And they brought a pretty garden variety RFRA claim. Now, Carl and Bill will talk a little bit more about kind of how these RFRA claims unfold, but the interesting thing, I think, is how the court approached this question in Hobby Lobby versus Burwell. It kind of, Justice Lyda's opinion kind of marched through the RFRA analysis with regard to substantial burden, assumed for the sake of argument that the government has a compelling interest in requiring coverage of these services. But then the government really lost the case on the issue of least restrictive means. Interestingly, in the litigation of Hobby Lobby, the government had, as a strategic matter, decided to invest a lot of effort into arguing that for-profit businesses were not covered or couldn't bring RFRA-related claims, arguing that they weren't persons for purposes of RFRA coverage. In hindsight, I think, I mean, I'm not in the business of giving advice to the Obama administration, but I would say that, but in hindsight, they probably should spend more time on the least restrictive means issue, because that's really where they lost the case, because the Supreme Court actually said that based on the Dictionary Act, that for-profit businesses are covered by RFRA as persons because they're corporations that are you know, within the meaning of that in the statute. And but yet, because the government had other means of delivering these kinds of services, that the claim had to succeed under RFRA. So Hobby Lobby won the case. But again, there were all these, and this is the case that's pending this spring, there were all these religiously affiliated nonprofit institutions, religious hospitals or social service agencies, universities and the like, that were granted by the administration an accommodation in the regulatory process, but weren't given a full exemption. The accommodation was one that said that the administration in early 2012 said, okay, you don't have to provide the coverage directly in your own plan, but instead you notify either HHS, and then there's a kind of complicated regulatory procedure where you notify your third-party administrator if you have one, if you're self-insured, or you notify your insurer, if you have a third-party insurer, that you object to providing this coverage, and then the insurer will take on, or third-party administrator will take on the responsibility of providing the coverage. And so the plaintiffs in these cases, Little Sisters of the Poor is probably the one that people are familiar with, that they've been following the case. The case actually captions Zubik versus Burwell. Zubik is the Bishop of Pittsburgh, who is the named plaintiff in a series of cases from that part of the country, are making the argument that basically, and I should, in full disclosure, say I'm the signatory to an amicus brief making this argument in part, is that still what you have there is the government's commandeering of the employer's insurance plan or its third-party administrator in order to provide coverage which the institution has sincere religious objections to. And that still constitutes a RFRA problem for the government, and the government can't show that the means it's used to achieve this is the least restrictive means, basically a rephrase of the Hobby Lobby argument. So we can spend a little more time talking about that, and I think Carl and Bill, and maybe question and answer, will have a little bit of a chance to flesh out some of those arguments. But let me just conclude here briefly with kind of some larger themes that I think are working their way through this debate. I want to talk about four very briefly. The first is this question of what constitutes a substantial burden for purposes of RFRA analysis. And the critics of the position of Hobby Lobby and Little Sisters say that courts have become, in court in Hobby Lobby and the courts were more solicitous of these claims, have become too deferential in terms of acknowledging an institution's claim of a substantial burden. And the courts should be a little more intrusive, if you will, that's probably somewhat plain term, but more intrusive with regard to whether or not something constitutes a substantial burden. And this is actually front and center in the Little Sisters case because of the issue I just mentioned. The government's view that, look, if you're just issuing a form and you're just notifying your third-party administrator, that can't be a substantial burden on your religious free exercise. That's a kind of trumped-up view of what constitutes a substantial burden. So that's it. That's kind of one of the key issues that's being talked about in the academic commentary and in the courts, is how deferential should that substantial burden inquiry be with regard to a religious institution's claim of a burden. And the second underlying issue, I think, is something I've mentioned in passing here, is sort of the contours of strict scrutiny, right? What constitutes a compelling interest? The court in Hobby Lobby, as as I said, assume for the sake of argument that there is a compelling interest in providing, requiring that these services be provided in covered health plans. But I think that will continue to be an issue. And then the least restrictive means inquiry, which again the government lost on in Hobby Lobby, but the question of what is the burden on the government to show, basically, or what alternatives can the government be forced to pursue in order to either succeed on or fail with regard to the least restrictive means prong of strict scrutiny. The third issue is what counts as a religious institution. I mentioned already that these regulations have kind of carved up some institutions that are sufficiently religious for purposes of exemption, others that are not. I think that will continue to be an ongoing theme in these debates. And then finally, come full circle back to what I said about kind of the Warren Berger era post-Sherbert, is kind of how the politics of religious freedom changed over the last several decades. Again, it tended to be, I think, speaking very broadly, 40 years ago or so, it tended to be more associated with the judicial and political left. Claims for religious freedom were paradigmatically small religious denominations like Jehovah's Witnesses or Seventh-day Adventists or people seeking draft exemptions, which were provided for in statutes during the Vietnam era. And now how it's become more identified quite strongly with political conservatives. And I think a lot of that has to do with the underlying issues. I think now that anti-discrimination laws and others are the context in which these religious freedom battles are being waged, and I think on that, alas, I think that it has led to an over-politicization of this debate in a way that I think actually is bad for religious freedom generally. And with that, I'll turn it over to Carl.
Our topic this morning could be called the Culture Wars. There was a book of that title published 25 years ago now, and sort of moved that phrase into our lexicon. The author of that book, James Davison Hunter, had a subtitle to his book, and it was the struggle to define America. The struggle that he was talking about is the same sort of struggle that we're talking about this morning. On the one hand, you have sort of historical, traditional, religious, orthodox peoples and groups, and on the other hand, you have social and political liberals or progressives. Of course, we're a room full of lawyers, so we like that the culture war takes place in the legal arena of legislation and litigation, and to some extent, increasingly, executive orders from governors and presidents. But you know, it's useful to step back and remind ourselves that the culture war takes place in several other arenas. And sort of the cutting edge of culture seems to be entertainment and arts. We're in the electoral politics arena, and we're finding out, to the surprise of some of us, what our fellow Americans think. But you know, as those results and pollsters are being reported, they fold back in and influence how people think because they hear what their fellow Americans are thinking. And there's, of course, the institutions of higher education and think tanks and the news media all have their role in this culture war. But coming back to the legal arena, the law is, to be honest, a bit of lagging indicator in terms of cultural change. We entertain the conceit that we're the deciders. Ultimately, you know, if it comes up in litigation and the court decides, well, then that's the resolution, and we move on to the extent that these things ever get decided. Also, it's useful to remind ourselves the culture war isn't new. It didn't start 25 years ago. If we went back 50 years, sort of the issues of the day between the same two groups, quite frankly, would be things like teacher-led prayer in public schools, or can you have a nativity scene on the courthouse lawn of your county at Christmas time. But if we move things now very quickly all the way forward to the present, the topic for the struggle between religion and progressive forces seems to be, I would say regretfully, but it having to do with human sexuality. And so that brings us into the gay, lesbian, transgender programs and agenda. And Part of that, of course, is same-sex marriage. So let me at least give passing mention here to the Obergefell versus Hodges case, the same-sex marriage case from the U.S. Supreme Court decided last June. Of course, it came out as everybody predicted that it would. Everybody even predicted that it would be 5-4, and everybody was right about that, and everyone predicted that Justice Kennedy would write the majority opinion, and of course we were all right about that as well. There were maybe two sort of minor surprises, which I think are useful to mention. One is that Justice Kennedy for the court put marriage on quite a pedestal. In other words, for a couple to get dignity meant that you had to be married. To get legitimacy meant that you had to be married. To get the imprimatur of the government meant that you had to be married. To have a stable family for your children meant that you had to be married. To take advantage of all of the economic benefits that the state would pour, and the federal government too, would pour upon married couples, well, you had to be married. Now, of course, to put marriage on a pedestal is really countercultural, because marriage is in decline. And so in one sort of ironic sense, when Kennedy put the institution of marriage on a pedestal, which of course some strains of feminists objected to, still do object to, meant it was a little bit of a conservative opinion, at least in that regard. The second thing, and then more mainstream to our topic this morning, is that Obergefell did not didn't talk about standard review, which meant that sexual orientation was not singled out as a protected class. Sexual orientation was not singled out for strict scrutiny or heightened review and so on. And in fact, Kennedy has a long history of not doing that. He had an opportunity in Lawrence versus Texas to give a heightened review or strict scrutiny. He didn't. He had an opportunity in U.S. versus Windsor, the DOMA case. And again, he was quite determined not to give strict scrutiny to sexual orientation. So that bears upon what we're talking about this morning, because it pushes the LGBT non-discrimination program into the legislative arena. So if non-discrimination is to become the law of the land, especially at state and local areas, it's going to have to take place by legislation. And of course, religious groups have some ways of pushing back. So Michael talked about federal RFRA. If there's a robust RFRA, as there was in Hobby Lobby, if that is maintained in the Zubin case, that will be one way for the religious faction to push back on the LGBT non-discrimination agenda. On the other hand, if Zubin comes out the other way, that of course will greatly weaken the ability of the traditional religious groups to push back at the federal level. And so let me move into the legislative arena, and which is to say, the Supreme Court's not going to carry forward the LGBT non-discrimination agenda as the court is presently constituted. As long as Justice Kennedy is on the court, there's not going to be heightened review for sexual orientation. So we move into this legislative arena, and I think it's useful to talk about it in two ways. One is federal, state, and local. At the federal level, there's a strong push by LGBT communities to get, as suspect classes, sexual orientation and gender identity into the full array of federal civil rights legislation. Now, I want to move to the state arena, because this is the Federalist Society, and so you're interested in, of course, state governance and state prerogatives. So at the state level, we have a really much more interesting picture. We have the wedding vendors issue, which was mentioned by Judge Osterhaus. We have a fair number of states still trying to enact state-level RFRAs, and that very much breaks into the news of Arizona or Indiana or Arkansas or Mississippi or Georgia and so on, where those efforts take place, and about 20 states, including Florida, already have state RFRAs. Kind of the flip side of that is a number of states, about a half dozen, have serious ongoing efforts to put into the state human rights acts as the protected classes of sexual orientation and gender identity. I understand that there's a Florida bill in that regard that some say has legs. And in particular, some kind of a new thing is that the LGBT program has enlisted successfully very large corporations to help push that through the state legislatures under the threats of business boycotts, or we'll take our business elsewhere, or we'll take our sporting events, C2A, national football games, and so on, elsewhere. And then, of course, we can push this all the way down to the municipal levels. Municipal politicians tend to be more liberal than the state in which the municipality is sitting, and so a number of municipalities, of course, have gay rights ordinances. There's been a little bit of pushback there, like Houston broke into the news, Springfield, Missouri broke into the news, where the people overturned what the municipal council did. Now I want to break down this arena, legislative, to some extent, executive order arena, a different way. I want to break it down in terms of the LGBT community or program. Pretty clearly is using the full array of legal processes or devices. So they're using regulatory powers, they're using tax powers, and they're using spending powers. So the regulatory powers, of course, we're a credentialed society. You have to have a license, you have to have a certification, you have to have an accreditation. You use all of those regulatory tools, and we're going to deny those to you if you continue to discriminate on the basis of LGBT. That would be the regulatory program. If you come back to the tax program, again, at the federal and state level, there's talk, although not so much at the federal level, of denying tax-exempt status if your organization discriminates on the basis of LGBT, once again. Or if you move to the spending power, federal government, state governments spend all kinds of money. They hire people, that's spending. They do grants, that's spending. They do contracts for goods and services, that's spending. They guarantee loans, they guarantee insurance, and so on. That's all of that spending power, and attached to those dollars, course, is non-discrimination on the basis of LGBT. So all of this is going forward, percolating at different levels in all of the states, including your own. The idea is to enlist the power of government to get traditional religious people not to recant their beliefs, but to act contrary to their beliefs, or to penalize them by denying government largesse and government imprimatur. Right, so let me conclude with maybe three observations. One is as to the culture war between these two groups, the traditional religious group has lost that culture war, and we're in a sort of a mop-up campaign at this point. They simply don't have the numbers to have the electoral power in government, and they don't have either their own people in high places of power, or people in high places of power that are sympathetic to their cause. There are counter exceptions, of course, but we're on the downside curve. These religious people know that they lost the culture war, and they've already pivoted. And their pivot is a plea for pluralism, a plea for diversity, a plea for religious exemptions, a live and let live society. So we have a wide, highly differentiated society. They just want to be a small part of that and have their social space. The LGBT community, like a good Civil War general, having won the battle, they want to win the war, and so they're going to pursue the defeated army vigorously, and so they're stiff-arming any attempt to get religious exemptions. All right, second observation. For the first time in the nation, we have a large number of Americans, maybe approaching 20%, who are prepared to articulate not only that they oppose religious liberty, people have always opposed religious liberty in one form or another, but that these traditional religious forces which are playing for religious liberty are actually deeply immoral. They're deeply evil. It's because these traditional religious groups are the cause, the primary cause, if not the only remaining cause, for oppression of LGBT people. So this oppression is treated like Jim Crow, and the rhetoric gets pretty heated. The third observation is within the traditional religious camp, or side of this, there's division. There are basically two camps, obviously I'm broad brushing here. The division is not acrimonious, but it is nonetheless very much a division. One camp is, well, we're going to fight on. We're going to continue to advocate. We're going to continue to ask for religious exemptions. We're going to continue to use our RFRA where we have it, our free exercise clause where it's pertinent, and so on. We're going to fight on and carry the good fight. The other faction is saying, no, this is actually this division, this anger, this perception that we're haters is actually hurting our religious faith. And what we want is we want to present a winsome face. We want to be non-judgmental. Much of our faith is not about human sexuality. It's about other things. Human sexuality is a side issue. And so we want to stop majoring on the minors. And so we're not going to fight this LGBT fight in the legal forums. I don't want to exaggerate it, but to a mild extent, the division also is demographic. Let us carry on the fight is a little bit older group, and we want to be non-judgmental and winsome to so that our faith be attractive. It is a somewhat younger group, often associated with millennials. So that's the very interesting landscape that all this is being carried on.
Hi, thanks for coming out, and particular thank you to the Federalist Society. I so much appreciate getting invited to speak to Federalist Society events. I'm on the board of the American Constitutional Society. I was a member of the Clinton administration. I'm not exactly the typical person you would expect to see at a Federalist Society event, but one thing I really admire about this organization is how open you are to actual real debate and real issues. And part of that comes from my own background. My dad was a conservative Republican, my mom was a liberal Democrat. It was only later in life I realized how much smarter my mother was, but that's an entirely different issue. Actually, today, I'm taking the conservative side because I'm going to argue that exemptions are problematic, that exemptions, and that's what a lot of what we're talking about, is really fundamentally against the rule of law. That would be the conservative side. How do I know that? Because Justice Scalia wrote the opinion of Smith, and because when Smith was decided, I defended him, and all my liberal friends jumped all over me for taking the wrong approach in that particular case. That said, I think what Michael and Carl talked about politics, is absolutely right. I mean, we've become, unfortunately, polarized along sexual issues in a way that has made us lose what is really liberal or conservative, or even if there is one in this area, and there actually may not be. I mean, interestingly enough, when Hobby Lobby was decided, there was another major religion case before the court that sort of dealing with the constitutionality of legislative prayer. The person who argued in favor of Hobby Lobby, who represented Hobby Lobby, also represented the plaintiffs in the case arguing that legislative prayer was unconstitutional, Doug Laycock. Although you would think that the normal conservative position would be that legislative prayer is okay and Hobby Lobby should get an exemption. The Obama administration, by the way, defended the constitutionality of legislative prayer, even as they were arguing that Hobby Lobby should be denied its exemption. So the politics in this area, if you really look through it, are not all that clear. This shouldn't be the political polarization device that's become, and I think on that we all agree. But before I come back to that at the end, let me talk a little bit about what the problem is with exemptions and free exercise exemptions, exemptions based on religious beliefs. As Michael gave us a really good history, we experimented that with that kind of approach after Justice Brennan's opinion in Sherbert saying compelling state interests would be required to justify the application of a law against a religious objection. Well, think about that. It's a strange kind of relief. Normally, when you bring a constitutional attack, the entire law gets struck down if you prevail. You don't get an exemption for yourself. And it's an unusual way of framing, and it's somewhat inconsistent with the way we normally look at law, that you would get an exemption. Religious exemptions are particularly problematic because they're boundless in scope. You can have a religious belief about anything. And it could be a legitimate religious belief about anything. I'm not going to second guess the Little Sisters of the Poor if they claim that it violates their religious conscience to have to file a paper of some kind. There are other very dramatic cases coming from the 60s, as you might imagine, with challenges to various substance control laws, which were claimed on religious basis. But anything can be characterized as a religious belief. There's one case coming out of Tennessee where somebody said he had a religious compulsion to dress as a chicken whenever he came into court. It's boundless in the kind of law that it can challenge. You can challenge anything on a religious basis. This is a nice libertarian argument, certainly, although it's a limited libertarian argument because it benefits only those who are able to couch their beliefs in religious terms. But there's virtually any kind of law, all laws, could be subject to a religious exemption challenge. And that leads to the problem of the inquiries that you need to do in order to decide these cases. How do you decide burden? I agree with Michael. We should be very reluctant to ask people how burdened are you by a particular religious belief. The only people who know how burdened they are the religious believers themselves. That's a problematic inquiry, but the opposite result is that you have to automatically defer. What about sincerity? Can we look in whether people sincerely believe what they're saying? Well, court says we can, but how do you do that? They said you can do that, but you can't do that by judging how reasonable the particular belief is. But how can you judge how people are sincere if you aren't at some level judging the legitimacy of the belief? And then how do you determine if something is religiosity? I think the end of the Sherbert regime came from a case that prevailed on free exercise. Smith was just cleaning up what happened afterwards. A case called Thomas versus Review Board. Thomas versus Review Board, a person working in Indiana, was moved from one line in a factory to one that was making gun turrets. And he came and said, I can't do that. My religion, I'm a Jehovah's Witness, my religion stops me from working on gun turrets. The lower court said this isn't a religious belief, it's a political belief. There was some evidence that Jehovah's Witnesses do not, as a formal precept, prevent you from working on gun turrets or armaments if that's what you want to do. But the United States Supreme Court said, look, hey, we aren't going to second guess if he thinks he's religious, this is a religious belief. We're not going to second guess that, although if you read the transcript, it's not even clear that Thomas, in that case, knew it was a religious belief or not. And by the way, think of that to yourself. How many of your strong beliefs that you have can you easily say are religious or secular? It's pretty hard even in our own minds to make that distinction often. And the court said we aren't going to look at the level of burden here. We're just going to defer to him and he wins. Although the court goes on to say that if he had just been presenting a philosophical belief, he would have lost. Now, does that make sense, or does that create an improper hierarchy between some beliefs that are couched in religious terms and other beliefs that look like they may be the exact same thing, that are the product of deep philosophical or moral precept? So they came one on that case, but I think the court then was very reluctant to go that far, because what it would effectively mean is that the jurisprudence would be, if it was taken seriously, and we're using the compelling interest test here, is a jurisprudence in which free exercise claims are easily raised, not easily opposed, and sustainable in an almost limited number of circumstances to the otherwise detriment of valid policies and programs. And what do I mean by that? It's not just that we're using the compelling interest test. It's also that we're using the compelling interest test in a very confined way. If somebody claims, I don't want to have to, I have a religious belief against paying the minimum wage, which actually was a real case. If you were taking the claim seriously, it's not whether the government has a compelling interest in having a minimum wage, it's whether or not the government has a compelling interest in making this particular company pay the minimum wage. And that's a much greater threshold because you have to apply it just against the person making the claim and not against a category of people regulating. So if you really took the three exercise theory seriously, they should win almost all cases, whoever is bringing the religious claim. It didn't happen prior to Sherbert, precisely for these reasons. The court wasn't going to go that far. So you get a hodgepodge of cases in which most of them, as Michael points out, are rejected. A few of them are upheld. Strange cases with Wisconsin versus Yoder. The Amish win, although it's not even clear that their claim was actually religious in basis. Okay, so Justice Scalia comes along, he recognizes all of this, and he says we aren't going to create a regime when every person becomes a law unto himself. That's a quote from Justice Scalia. And since Justice Scalia said it, all my friends on the left said it's got to be wrong. But some of us argued actually he's right here. You can't make this regime work. RFRA comes along, and Justice Scalia does something that hasn't been done before or since, which is he brings the entire spectrum of folks together, and they pass RFRA, except for one group. And I think this one exception may show you, again, another problem with exemption. The one group that opposed RFRA was the Catholic Church. And the reason why the Catholic Church opposed RFRA is they were concerned, they thought that Roe versus Wade was going to be overturned, and they were concerned that if there was a general prohibition against abortion, they didn't want people to make religious claims that they would be entitled to have an abortion. Which gets us, I think, back to where we are at the end of the conversation today. Why are certain folks now very enthusiastic about religious claims and other ones aren't, is because we've changed the kind of laws that are subject to these kinds of issues in a way that wasn't before. The Smith case itself was a very sympathetic case for the religious believer. It was part of a Native American ritual of ingesting peyote. Now, I haven't done it, but I am told that ingesting peyote is not a pleasant experience. It may be hallucinogenic, that might be the fun part of it. But it also has a lot of digestive side effects that are not pleasant at all. It had been in practice for over 100 years, and the court said, Justice Scalia said, no religious right of an exemption. That's a very powerful claim. And interestingly, when people were talking about passing RFRA, nobody was talking about reversing that particular law, because the politics were we got to enforce drug laws, generally. So this leads to a very strange kind of dynamic if what we're really talking about is protecting religious beliefs as opposed to protecting what our political inclinations might want to be. Now, I think Hobby Lobby is going to fall under its own weight for the same reason that Sherbert fell under its own weight. It's not workable for the reasons we talked about before. There are a lot of incentives for people to make claims. Such, for example, I don't want to pay minimum wages. The distinction between what's a political claim and what's a religious claim is not going to be different. A case coming out of the Sixth Circuit, somebody wanted the same kind of exemption from the contraceptive mandates of RFRA. Basically said, the reason why I want it is I don't think the government has got a right to make me provide services. Okay, nice libertarian argument. It's not a religious argument. But people are going to be influenced to make their claims on a religious basis, which I don't think does much in the way of promoting respect for religious belief. You know, I want to get back to just briefly the last couple of seconds here to talk about what I think Carl and Michael's major point is, which is that politically, we are going down the wrong road in this area. And I think whether you're on the left, the right, the center, you've got to think that's right. You know, we should be respecting minority beliefs of one kind or another, and just one side happens to take the majority, that shouldn't make that respect go away for religious beliefs. And on the other hand, we should also recognize that there is a rule of law there which doesn't allow for individualized exemptions under certain circumstances. The religion clauses are particularly problematic because we don't even understand the meaning of the underlying term, religion. And even defining that term creates constitutional problems. Tell somebody that their belief isn't religious when they think it is. All kinds of free exercise, all kinds of establishment. Saying that something is religious when it may not be, all kinds of establishment issues. These are very difficult issues that we need to get behind and forget what it, and try to put at least aside the political dispute we're having on the hot button issues and try to get to the fundamental issues of religious freedom that we're really talking about here. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Marshall. Before we turn to questions, and I hope you're thinking of questions to ask the panelists out there, we'll get to that in a second. But why don't we go down the line here, Professor Warren, Professor Esbeck, Professor Marshall, with any reactions?
I have a question for Bill. Would your skepticism apply to legislative exemptions as well?
No, I think there are problems with legislative exemptions, but interpreting a statute, interpreting the meaning of religion, for example, under the conscientious exemption statute, I think doesn't get you into some of the constitutional problems are as if you were going to create a definitive definition of religion. It still gets you to the problems of sincerity and some of these other problems. But I think Justice Scalia was right in Smith when he suggested there is some room for a legislative exemption, although I think you can go overboard on that. I think if you provided certain kinds of exemptions for religious speech, but not for secular speech, that might create speech clause problems because of the lack of content neutrality.
I guess I'm responding to Bill Marshall's comment. First, we have, in the United States, we have a long tradition, very long since even before we became a nation, of accommodating or exempting religious practices. The way we've always been religiously diverse by European standards, and so we even in our own revolution we exempted Quakers and other religious pacifists from fighting. There were some state law cases where Quakers refused to take their hat off before authorities, including judges, and judges insisted that everybody take their head cover off while in the courtroom, and the Quakers were accommodated. Even in our own Constitution, in the very text, we have a religious accommodation. It's a religious offense to some to have to swear because of a New Testament passage. But so we wrote into our Constitution that you can affirm rather than swear. So there's a long tradition there. I think you exaggerate the problem of administering RFRA, and you could just look at Hobby Lobby and what the majority did there. For example, substantial burden. The court very nicely dealt with that. They said what Congress means by that is how much pressure is being put on the religious believer to recant or not follow their religious practice. And the pressure there was massive fines collected by the IRS, millions of dollars. It's not a difficult problem. And looking at the pressure, that's a secular assessment. You know, how many dollars do you have to pay? Are you going to go to jail? Are you going to lose your license? Are you going to lose your accreditation? Those are secular questions. They aren't particularly difficult. You said that there's incentive to invoke RFRA, but it hasn't happened. There's not a lot of RFRA cases. You said that, it's very difficult for a court to answer religious questions, and so we defer, as if deferring was a bad thing. In America, we don't have heresy trials. We do not tell people that you don't understand your religion properly, and Uncle Sam understands it better than you do. That's what a heresy trial is. We don't do that. So deference is a good thing and ought to be lauded. And you said, well, these religion cases are tough. Well, free speech cases are tough. Free speech law is complex. It's actually more complex than the free exercise area. Does that mean we're going to abandon free speech? No. The difficulty of it, you know, that's why we have bright judges.
Professor Esbeck, do you think that, go ahead.
No. Carl and I have been doing this for years. In fact, I almost missed my plane down here. Because I was coming from Raleigh, and Michael sent the note saying that they were going to channel what I would have had to say. I almost thought of sneaking in the back of Raleigh to listen to how they would have channeled what I would have had to say. Just quickly responding to Carl, I didn't say I was against deference. I actually think deference is what you need to do. The problem is that if you completely defer, you take away one of the threshold problems of a claim fatigue. And when you add the compelling interest test, you have basically made every law that is challenged presumptively invalid. And that is inconsistent with the rule of law. With respect to burdens, there are actually two types of burdens. One is the secular fine that can be placed. But the other part is the burden on the religious believer, not just having to pay a fine, but is there but trying to determine whether or not their belief is actually infringed by a particular requirement. And that is a very difficult kind of inquiry to make. Was Thomas really burdened by having to work on a gun turret when he said that he wasn't burdened by working on another manufacturing line in that same factory? These are very difficult kinds of inquiries to make, irrespective of whatever civil penalty might be attached.
I'm interested in that question, too. And let me follow up. But first, why don't we start lining up? If you have a question for the panel, why don't we go ahead and start lining up the microphone so that you can bring those. And in the meantime, I'm interested, Professor Esbeck, in your response as to what tools the courts have to ferret out religious belief that is real versus the religious beliefs that just allows me to violate the drug laws with impunity or other laws.
Well, first of all, again, the Thomas question was easy. He faced pressure. He'd either work on that tank turn or be fired. He lost his job. So he faced substantial pressure. Loss of a job is substantial pressure. We haven't talked about this because it doesn't often arise except in prisoner lawsuits where prisoners are serving religious rights. And that is, the court has always said, U.S. versus Ballard, 1944, 1943, that courts can test whether the religious claimant is sincere. And that's still true under RFRA as well. That the government doesn't usually challenge sincerity because they don't doubt the sincerity. Doubted the sincerity of Little Sisters of the Poor, that they were following Catholic doctrine opposing contraceptions. Nobody doubted the Green family, that is the owner of Hobby Lobby, that they were pro-life, they opposed abortion, and they thought drugs were abortifacients, and therefore killing unborn children from the Green family religious perspective. So the government didn't doubt that, and that's why they don't raise the sincerity test. But the sincerity test is there to get at charlatans, fakers, and liars. And sometimes, and that's why I mentioned prisons, prisoners sometimes have too much time on their hands, and so they'll make religious claims, and they'll just dummy up the religion. So the sincerity test does sometimes get invoked in that particular context. But it's not just a matter of deference. The First Amendment itself mandates that judges not get into religious questions. Religious questions are about the importance or validity of a religious belief. And again, that's because we don't have heresy trials. So Congress set up RFRA the way it did, paralleling Sherbert. And if there needs to be more elements in the prima facie case before shifting the burden to the government to show compelling government interest, least restricted means, then Congress can fix that by changing the statute. But right now, the court has said substantial burden is about pressure, secular pressure, and the sincerity test is there if there's reasonable speculation that we have a charlatan or a faker.
Questions from you?
My name is Josh Grosshands from the Orlando chapter. Professor Marshall, I think I speak for all the Federalists when I say you're always welcome here among us. I'm curious, when you make the point that the exemptions are problematic, do you have another mechanism that you would propose to protect free exercise and religious liberties if we were to do away with some of these exemptions?
You know, it's harsh. I think specific legislative exemptions as opposed to the freewheeling RFRAs, I think, is a little better. I mean, like conscientious objection requirements in the draft, I think, are a little better. But I think it's harsh. I mean, I have to disagree with Carl again, because they had to ask in Thomas not just what the secular effect was, but whether he was burdened internally. And that's a really difficult question to ask, and trying to decide that one way or another is very difficult. In Ballard, the question was whether or not somebody who had been going around the country claiming that he was a faith healer was engaging in fraud. Now, how do you decide that? Whether somebody is really doing that without testing not just whether he was sincere in his belief, but whether we actually believe that faith healing by this particular person was what he believed in, or was just a way for him to raise money. I mean, there are a lot of these difficult free exercise cases come up all the time with respect, where there's clearly self-motivation in order to do it. I don't think there was that kind of self-motivation in Hobby Lobby with respect to the Greens. But certainly the Tony and Susan Alamo case that they objected to the Fair Labor Standards Act, there's a lot of self-motivation there. And I'm not sure we can construct a doctrine which says you can get free exercise exemptions in certain circumstances, but you can't when you get an economic advantage out of it. So I find it very difficult.
If I can just add a quick note, though, that seems to me that's why the government's case in Little Sisters is actually so weak. My perspective, see if the Supreme Court agrees, because the government has granted exemptions to the contraceptive mandate for some religious institutions, knowing that it poses a burden to those religious institutions, but then set about gerrymandering other religious institutions who would not get that same exemption. And it seems to me that it's a huge problem for the government on the least restrictive means prong, and it basically concedes the point about substantial burden.
I'm Carolyn Parlato from Cal IC Florida. I wanted to raise the question of Sharia law, which is part of Islam. In my opinion, Islam is at least as much a political system as a religious system. But at some point, I think devout Muslims will raise Sharia points which directly conflict with our law. And I'd be interested if y'all had any opinions.
Yeah, what would happen there, maybe in the family law context, or divorce, alimony, custody issues?
The logic of exemption says you can't pick and choose among religions. If there's a legitimate religious belief, sincere, and it's burdened, you recognize it whether or not under any circumstances. You can't pick and choose among religions.
You know, if there's domestic violence, child abuse, things of that nature, I think pretty clearly our courts would, if it came to litigation, would find compelling government interest by least restrictive means. I would also point out that Christian communities have their own private dispute resolution systems. There's a large private nonprofit organization called Christian Conciliation Service, and when two private parties voluntarily enter into a contract that then derails a lawsuit and moves it into the area of arbitration and mediation, and then arbitration, if mediation fails through the Christian Conciliation Service, that's a private dispute resolution.
system, and it's hard to differentiate that from Sharia. But obviously, Christian Conciliation Service isn't going to cover up child abuse or spousal violence and so on.
But thinking again on with that question on the, say there is an arbitration agreement there, and one of the spouses comes into divorce court and claims, well, this is what our religion demands that we do.
Well, if you're posing a question of whether the courts honor and hence not adjudicate an arbitration award, that would happen in any kind of commercial context or a domestic context.
Yes, I was thinking more in the absence of it, and somebody raises a religious claim that this is what our religion dictates, that I get custody, father gets custody regardless, because this is our religion. Does that force the other spouse to abdicate their religion, or does...
In the absence of an agreement, there's no... The courts don't defer. There is a doctrine called church autonomy, but it's a fairly narrow scope, and it has to do with simply the church deciding questions as to its own ecclesiology, which is the internal governance thereof, but it doesn't spill over into members and divorce, and so the church autonomy doctrine isn't anywhere as close to that problem.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a particularly separation view of the First Amendment of the Establishment Clause, but I should say that it seems to me that that if it means anything, if one thing it means is that church, religious, institutional forms of, say, granting divorce or whatnot have an autonomous character, but so also does the civil laws mechanisms for divorce and adjudication of child custody, for example. I mean, it depends a lot on the particular case, but I guess I just think that most of the time that would get worked out.
One more question out there.
Oh, it's one more. Professor Esbeck, you pointed out, I think, the glaring absence of a standard of review outlined from Justice Kennedy's decisions and Lawrence and Winster and Obergefell. I have to think that that's intentional. Do you have any thoughts on why he would not have provided a sort of standard of review for sexual orientation cases? Is it a hesitancy to group that with the strict scrutiny standard of the classes, or is there perhaps some type of hesitancy about that type of standard review altogether from Justice Kennedy?
Well, in my remarks, I did say it's clearly intentional, because that's a long pattern for him. I also said, this is speculative, but I said as long as the court is constituted with the 9 justices we have, which of course would include Justice Kennedy, that's not going to change. Although, as a lot of people point out, some of the justices are quite elderly, and one or two have had health issues, so maybe the court won't be constituted as it presently is for a lot longer. But whoever's the new president will get those appointments. You're asking me even something really risky, to read Justice Kennedy's mind. Well, okay, for what it's worth, which is like, this is $2, it'll get you a cup of coffee at Starbucks, right? $2.50. I agree with you. You answered your own question. I think it's unknown
what it would mean to say under substantive due process, equal protection in the 14th Amendment, that sexual orientation gets strict scrutiny. It's just not quite clear where that would go. Just like back when the court didn't want to say gender was a suspect class, so they did a halfway measure. They said it was quasi-suspect. I think Kennedy is not, he can't foresee where that might go, and so would rather do the incremental thing to let the lower courts, bit by bit by bit, strike down any time where there's straight state action that discriminates on the basis of sexual orientation. Just do it bit by bit. When you do it in little steps, you know exactly what the consequence will be.
One more question.
Thank you. Have a quick question here that I know is on some folks' minds as well, and wanted to pose a little bit. You know, there's been some discussion about there are going to be areas where whether something is truly a religious belief or not is questionable. And I've seen prisoner litigation, and that can be the case. But I think that we would all probably agree, or at least if we're reasonable, we would, that there are certain things that are core religious beliefs that really for centuries have been core religious beliefs. So it's would be difficult to question them as a religious belief, even without entangling ourselves too deeply in the doctrine. I think one of those, until very recently, for most of your denominations that you would have found in this country, and at the Judeo-Christian tradition, would have been the belief that marriage constitutes a man and a woman. If you go back 40 years, there was really no debate anywhere on the spectrum as to that. If that were true, if we say that's a sincere belief, then my question is, how is that handled if we're talking religious entities? And my second question is, how do we draw distinctions between religious entities? The Soviet Union at one point had religious freedom. The only issue was it could only be exercised within houses of worship that were state sanctioned, of which there were three. And if you had practiced it outside of those three, there was no freedom. Why should we treat a not-for-profit or a for-profit entity that has a religious foundation differently than a church? And I'd like to get the feedback from the panelists on that.
Well, I mean, I'm in concurrence with the thrust of your last point. I do, as I indicated in my remarks very briefly, I think this question of what counts as a religious institution is, I think that, particularly in the current climate, it's become more problematic than to be. So, for example, in the Title VII exemption for religious discrimination, that is to say that religious institutions are exempt from the prohibition on religious discrimination, there's a quite large, capacious understanding of what counts as a religious institution there. And I think an unfortunate part of the whole HHS litigation has been the administration's kind of conceptual gymnastics about what counts as a religious institution for purposes of the exemption there. And I even think there are cases like Larson v. Valente, which was a old case from the, not so old, but a case about, you know, basically that the government has limitations on its ability to kind of engage in denominational favoritism, which I think is part of the problem. And on the first point, I mean, as these same-sex discrimination cases wend their way through the courts, I don't know that it will ever much be challenged that traditional religious institutions have a sincerely held belief that, for example, that same-sex marriage should not be recognized within their denominations and such. I just think that the question will go to the next level of if it's, for example, a state or federal RFRA type claim with regard to, for example, compelling interest. So does the government have a compelling interest in a blanket prohibition on same-sex discrimination, such as, for example, federal contractors, let's say, or grant recipients would be prohibited from engaging in same-sex discrimination, including religious institutions, and how would the courts analyze that under the RFRA analysis? But I don't think on the sincerity issue there'd be much doubt.
Your question is really a rich one, and we could spend a long time dealing with it. Let me just deal with a couple things first. What Thomas indicated was that when we're looking at religious beliefs, it's highly individualistic. In Thomas's case, there was no indication he was Jehovah's Witness. That Jehovah's Witness doctrine supported what he was doing, but the court said that really didn't make a difference. It's what he believes. And people's beliefs change over time. I certainly think that if you're reciting a belief that many people are familiar with, it's more likely to survive the sincerity test at a quicker level than if it was a new one as a practical matter. Now, whether that's good or not, it's a different question, because people can freshly have new religious belief. The question I really want to talk to you about, for-profit corporations. I'm not saying Justice Alito's decision in Hobby Lobby was wrong on that, because he was construing a statute, and I think what Congress was intending, whether they were intending to include for-profit corporations or not, I think was not clear. I think they could have a legitimate belief on that. In terms of whether you should include for-profit corporations, though, I think that gets a little bit more problematic. Because after all, part of the idea of the corporation is to insulate the person from liability. So you're taking the advantage by creating an entity that separates itself from you, and unless the corporate veil is pierced, you're safe. If you're beginning to say that, no, I really am this corporation, then why do you have a corporate veil? I think that's a little inconsistent with what the idea of a corporation is, as well as somewhat inconsistent with the idea that when you're going out into the marketplace and trying to achieve a profit, you're engaging in a fundamentally different enterprise than being a church or a nonprofit.
Corporations have all kinds of social messages, though, right? They have messages on the environment, they have messages on, I mean, a lot of them filed recent affirmative action cases, I mean, so they have lots of views about, you know, contested political religious matters. I mean,
and they could be subject to a fiduciary, they could be subject to a suit if they use those beliefs in a way that harms profits.
I want to try to answer your question too. And you use the religious belief concerning same-sex marriage. You could also use the religious belief which traditional religious groups hold in homosexual practice is wrong. But we'll use your example of same-sex marriage. The LGBT community, rather strategically, have said, look, we're not going to force churches to host same-sex marriages if they don't want to. And we're not going to force clerics, ministers, pastors, and so on, rabbis, who are opposed, for religious reasons, opposed to same-sex marriage, we're not going to force them to marry these people. The problem is when you move away from the church, qua church, and the minister who is ordained, to just ordinary lay people. An example of that is magistrates. So this same-sex marriage case comes down. There are magistrates who are religious who did marriages. Now they're asked to do same-sex marriages. Can they object to that? Well, the states have responded to that differently. Iowa, which adopted same-sex marriage early on, said, well, as long as our magistrates don't marry anybody, then that's okay. They could not marry same-sex couples. They just don't marry anybody. North Carolina, I think, said, no, you have to marry everybody. You can't refuse to do marriages, and you have to marry everybody. And so I guess, according to press reports, a couple dozen magistrates who had traditional religious Christian beliefs resigned, and then legislation was passed and allowed them to not marry anybody and reinstated those magistrates. Came from North Carolina, Bill knows, he has a better grasp of the facts there. But Ohio has said no to their magistrate. You got to marry everybody, and you can't just decline to marry anybody. If you have been marrying people in the past, you've got to now, contrary to your religious beliefs, marry a same-sex couple. That's wrong. But that's obviously going to be litigated, and we'll have to see. But I think they ought to win that free exercise claim. But we'll see. It's Ohio, and so the federal RFRA doesn't apply.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you very much to the panelists.